You just keep going up, right? So necessary. If there's going to be the satisfaction of the things that we need, God's saying, I'm going to provide those, isn't he? There's a lot of symbolism there in the desert and all the. Well, what is the desert to us right now? We're kind of close to the desert. We have been here for a while, haven't we? Had like 3 years of almost desert time here. But what is the desert in your life? Have you ever gone through a desert time in your life? You know, from one day to the next, it can seem like a desert, can it? Part of your day can seem like a desert. But there's things that we need in our life. And either we're going to go to the promise that we have in God, or we're going to try to fulfill it in our own way in one way or another, right? But I like this. He says, I'm going to, wherever you're at, when you're on the heights, when you're in the valleys, I promise to not leave you alone. I like that. It says, I'm not going to forsake you. I'm going to be there for you. I'm going to be your water truck. Provide you with the water. John 4. Let's go to John 4. Man, you know, I actually came across a scripture in Proverbs where it says, the heart of the king, I think it was Proverbs 21. The heart of the king is like a stream in the hand of God. I'm not saying it exactly right, but I wasn't going to put it in here, but I like this. So it's kind of what got me going down this road. In the Lord's hand, the king's heart is a stream of water that he channels toward all who please him. Isn't that neat? Now let me show you what I got out of that. I grew up in eastern Colorado where there's not a whole lot. I think we had 10 inches of rain a year. So that's kind of a dry part of the country. That's not very much. We got that. We got 12 inches in Marble Falls. Remember that one? What was that, about 4 years ago or so? 12 inches in an hour or so, like that. I mean, it just dumped. It was a whole bunch. So we didn't have much. So what they had, though, was an aquifer underneath the ground, and they would put these great big V8 engines, you know, and they would pump that out of the water. But then you got to do something with the water when it comes out. And so what they had these big pipes and these trailers, and a big part of the farm boy job is to move those pipes to different parts of the field to channel the water where it needs to go. And so you come from the pump, but then it's got to go where it needs to go. I saw that. I said, God's actually, even if it's a ruler that we might not agree with, we can take a scripture like that, and we can trust that God, even though that guy doesn't know what he's doing, God is taking things and he's channeling it to those. And it said to those who please him, right? Now, that's not a works thing. That's just somebody who's going to him. How does God get pleased by us when we go to him? Amen? It's not when we do something right. It's just when we go to him. He knows if we just go to him, things will be made right. Right? He's about relationship. He says, it just pleases me when you come. Braden just pleases the socks off of me. I like the way he says Poppy for one thing. But I mean, we were at the school yesterday just picking him up, and I'm out in the parking lot standing next to the truck, and I have my back to him. I hear, Poppy! And I turn around, and he comes running to me, you know, and hugs me, you know, and it's like, that just makes me so happy. And then if he does something wrong, what's that? He's over there? Oh, he's asleep. Oh. I like putting him to sleep, too. Our ritual is I read to him, and I scratch his back, and I pray, and then he goes to sleep. So he's used to that, and I am, too. I like it. That's the way God is. He says, you please me by coming to me. And just by going to him and having a relationship, you can trust that he's channeling the source of life, which is the streams, towards you. Even if it's a, even if, even in, if it's a, administration that isn't right, God's still going to channel the things that need to come to you. Amen? Is that good? John 4, 10. So this is such a famous story to me. Jesus is meeting the woman at the well, and what is he doing there? He says, can you give me something to drink? He says, he might have even thought about this before. It's like, this is going to be a good one. Maybe not. But he's going to the well, and he said, can you give me something to drink? And they get a conversation going about this. And Jesus answers her in verse 10. He says, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. She had never heard of that kind before. Sir, the woman said, you have nothing to draw with. What are you talking about? And the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock? And Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. This is an amazing thing. It's like, I thought I was going somewhere to get the drink, and Jesus says, that drink's going to come out of the inside of you. It's going to be with you wherever you go. Amen? So, let's go to John 7 also here. Verse 37. Jesus really used this as a strong thing. He says, this is going to be living water. It's never going to pass away. It will be true life, eternal life in you, right? On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. He's saying the same thing again, isn't he? That's kind of a weird thought, isn't it? The thing that's going to satisfy me is coming from the inside of me. It's kind of weird, isn't it? And yet that's what he's saying. He's saying, come to me, and I'll give you a water that's going to be on the inside of you, and it's going to bubble over, spill over. That's kind of a mystery, isn't it? What's that? It's really amazing. By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Jesus came, and once he was glorified and went up to heaven, it was possible for anybody to become a new creation in Christ, to be born again, to have a new life on the inside of them. But then there was something else that actually came on them, wasn't there? On the day of Pentecost, up in the upper room, something came on them, and it was actually being poured out on them. Poured out until it went in and came out some more. It overflowed. Somehow this didn't get into my... But Acts 2, I believe it's 17. Maybe you can help me with this. Remember, Peter comes out, and all these people are speaking in languages that everybody's understanding because they're from other parts of the country. And he said, this is what was prophesied in Joel, that in the last days I'll pour out my Spirit. There's this understanding that there's a pouring of a source of life that you don't get unless it's being poured. You're parched without it, right? Then later on, I think it's, is it verse 33? He says it again. He said, this is that which was spoken of that's going to be poured out. There's this imagery of the water of life. So let's go to Ezekiel. This is a really interesting prophecy from Ezekiel that talks about this. Ezekiel 47, and we're going to go through a part of this because it's very interesting. I happened to come across a commentary that a guy was talking about how the temple was when Solomon actually built it. Just how magnificent it was. The gates on it were 75 feet high. How many of you know how high 75 feet is? You know, if you got a two-story house, that's about 20 feet. The top, the edge of the second story. So it'll be like 3.5 times a two-story house. And that's just the gates. And then they were plated with bronze and, you know, all these different metals and everything. And so he was talking about just how majestic it was. How he said when you were coming from a long ways away, it would glow in the sun. In fact, you had to cover your eyes up. It would be so bright. Coming up on it. But then you come inside that gate, and anybody could go through those gates. Gentiles, anybody could go through those gates. And it was kind of an area where there was some business and stuff that would take place. But then there would be another gate, and all the Jews could go through that gate, and they could get up in another area, another court. And then beyond that, the women had to stay back. And then beyond that, I don't know how many of those there were, but finally, there was the Holy of Holies. And only one guy could go in there once a year. And they put bells on the bottom of his robe in case he didn't have it all together. They'd pull him out, and they put a rope on him and bells on the bottom, and they'd listen. If the bell stopped, they'd start pulling on the rope because he was a goner. They should have put a story about how that happened because that would have been kind of interesting too. But only one guy went into the Holy of Holies because that's where the glory was, right? And there was a veil that priest would pass through to get into that place. It was a really thick veil that there's no way it would just happen to rot and fall apart. But when Jesus was crucified, you know what happened? It tore right down the middle. In an impossible way, it tore. And it made way for anybody to go into the Holy of Holies that came by the blood of Jesus. Right? So, Ezekiel is actually talking about this temple here. And I'm going to read through it. But I wanted to kind of explain it a little bit so you understand some of what's going on. I'll go ahead and give it a little bit of a synopsis. I don't want to get too far ahead, but there's a river that's coming out from the Holy of Holies in the temple. And Ezekiel's observing this. He said, I see this water coming out. And it's coming out just a little stream out from the Holy of Holies. He said, I watch it, but the further it comes out and it goes through these different gates and it comes, in fact, once it gets outside of the temple altogether, it keeps getting bigger. The further it gets away from the temple, the wider and the deeper it gets. So let me read this. The man brought me back to the entrance to the temple, and I saw water coming out from under the threshold of the temple toward the east, for the temple faced east. The water was coming down from under the south side of the temple, south of the altar. He then brought me out through the north gate and led me around the outside to the outer gate facing east, and the water was trickling from a south side. As the man went eastward with a measuring line in his hand, he measured off 1,000 cubits and then led me through water that was ankle deep. He measured off another 1,000 cubits and led me through water that was knee-deep. He measured off another 1,000 and led me through water that was up to the waist. How far would that be by now? Might be a mile or so, right? It's quite a ways.
He asked me, Son of man, do you see this? Then he led me back to the bank of the water. When I arrived there, I saw a great number of trees on each side of the river. He said to me, this water flows toward the eastern region and goes down into the Araba, where it enters the Dead Sea. When it empties into the sea, the salty water there becomes fresh. Swarms of living creatures will live wherever the river flows. There will be large numbers of fish because this water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. So where the river flows, everything will live. Fishermen will stand along the shore from En Gedi to En Gla'im. There will be places for spreading nets. The fish will be of many kinds, like the fish of the Mediterranean Sea. But the swamps and marshes will not become fresh. They will be left for salt. Fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both banks of the river. Their leaves will not wither, nor will their fruit fail. Every month they will bear fruit, because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their fruit will serve for food, and their leaves for healing. So, are you familiar with this story a little bit? It's kind of an interesting story. It says, wherever this river flows, even when it gets to the ocean, what's the problem with the ocean? I think he might have been talking about the Dead Sea, because nothing lives there, right? He said, but where that water, it hits that salty water and it becomes fresh. Even in the places where nothing could live before, there's going to be life. Where's that coming from? It's coming from the Holy of Holies. And it's actually a prophecy of the Holy Spirit. That the further away it gets from, remember what happened? You had the upper room and the Holy Spirit was poured out. And the further it went from there, they went all over the known world at that time, and it just got deeper and deeper. And wherever it went, there was life. Amen? And I did have those two scriptures. It was Acts 2:17 and 2:33, like I said, and I had them in the wrong order. That's what was prophesied, and that's what took place. It was poured out. What happened? Jesus was so excited about it. He said, I'm going to leave, and when I do, I'm going to send a comforter, and you're going to get filled up to overflowing. Right? Let me go back to that. Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink, and whoever believes in me, as Scripture said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. We were saying, that's kind of a mystery kind of a thing, isn't it? And Ezekiel kind of makes it more understandable, I believe. That we've been taken into the Holy of Holies, and the Holy Spirit's actually poured out on us. And wherever we go now, we're carrying a depth of the Spirit. In fact, that's why it's important when we come together. There's a magnification of that river of life when we come together. And it's so necessary for us to be flowing in it ourselves, to go to the Holy of Holies ourselves, and to be ensconced in this anointing. And what happens as a result of that? Trees begin to grow on this. Yeah, it begins to bear fruit. Man, are you passionate about that? That's why I was wondering if we're all thirsty. Jesus said, who's thirsty? Because if you are, you're going to go there. You're going to get filled. And wherever you go, wherever that river of life flows, said wherever it went, it brought life. And there was a continual bearing of fruit because in that water was the life for the fruit. Amen? Isn't that good? Isaiah 11:9. This is a prophetic thing. So, going back to that scripture about the king, sometimes we can be deceived into thinking that things aren't moving like we would like for them to. We get in our little world, we see something going on, or even, you know, our country, what's going on in our country and in the world, and God says, I am moving. And you can either thirst for me and come and drink, or you can get your eyes off on this other stuff and miss out on what I'm doing. God's moving right now. Yes,
His Spirit's moving right now. Who goes there? The ones that get in the water. And they'll get satisfied, won't they? If you're thirsty, there's a way to be satisfied. If there's stuff that's dead around you, there's a way to bring life to it. You go there yourself. Amen? And it'll come from the inside of you. Be a river of life. Isaiah 11:9. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. You know what the Holy Spirit comes to reveal? It comes to reveal Jesus. With this living water, he said, you come to me, didn't he? And I'll give you this living water. You come to me. It's going to be revealing him. You get filled up with that water, and it's going to be revealing Jesus. The knowledge of the glory of the Lord, it's prophesied. It's going to cover the whole earth. Like the waters cover the sea. How do the waters cover the sea? You don't see anything underneath it anymore, do you? I hear there's mountains, and there's all kinds of stuff under there. My brother-in-law does fiber optics. They provide, you know, communication avenues to different... I didn't realize those fiber optic cables actually go all the way under the ocean, all the way to Australia. I get on my iPad right now. I could do this right now. My sister lives in Australia, and you can FaceTime, and there's hardly any delay, hardly any latency. It's going speed of light to Australia. So if you go under the ocean, I don't know how I got on that, but I thought it's kind of interesting. If you go down in the ocean, you're going to see all kinds of stuff. But above the water, you don't see a thing because it's all covered, isn't it? He says, I'm going to cover the whole earth as the water covers the sea. So all you're going to, all when you get in this, you're not going to see the stuff underneath anymore. It's all going to be covered by the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. Amen? And it'll satisfy completely. Jeremiah 2:13. So, this sounds like a pretty cool deal, doesn't it? But it's possible to be swigging down a Pepsi when you got purified water sitting right next to it. Or swigging down some other substance that's going to actually take your life, when right next to it is the life. And so Jeremiah talks about this. He says, my people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me. Remember God said, I'm not going to forsake you. I'm going to be there for you. God's really passionate about he's in love with us. He wants to pour his goodness out on us in a big measure, right? He said, but they've committed two sins. They've forsaken me, the spring of living water. That's who I am. And they've forsaken me and dug their own cisterns. I'm just going to go take care of myself. Broken cisterns that can't even hold water. They've gone into the world in some way and they're trying to satisfy the thing that only God can give. So I'm going to pour it out. But are you going to be satisfied by it? Not if you forsake me. I'm so glad that God's sight is always there all the time. He's faithful all the time. And he says, all you got to do is come to me. You don't have to get all your P's and Q's in the right order. You don't have to do everything right. You don't have to, you know. Just come to me. Don't forsake me. Get satisfied with me. Be thirsty and be satisfied in me. Amen? So it almost becomes like if you're embracing being parched, it's almost a sin, isn't it? If it's not condemnation, but if you're not being satisfied, if you're not being gratified by the living water, and it's not changing you and making you be happy, It should just be a cue. Go to the water store. You know? Be satisfied. Don't forsake. You know, you actually have to go away from things if you're forsaken. You were there, but you took off and you left it. You've left it. Have you ever done that with God? You know better. And somehow you're in these doldrums that he didn't give you because you're drinking the wrong stuff. I've done this in the summertime. I'll get to working in the heat. And Pepsis just don't satisfy. Even I remember one time I got really dehydrated and I tried to drink one of those, or the Gatorade. Made me sick. Have you ever? I don't know. Maybe it's just me, or maybe it was just my condition at that time, but that did not. I heard about it, commercials about it, but boy, it didn't work for me. And somehow I have to make myself drink water when I'm like that. It's weird. What's wrong with me? I have to drink water on purpose. I can't leave it. I can't take off from it. I have to drink it. Amen? Jeremiah 17:13. Lord, you are the hope of Israel. All who forsake you will be put to shame. Those who turn away from you will be written in the dust because they have forsaken the Lord, the spring of living water. I thought that was an interesting imagery there. All who forsake him will be written in the dust. That means they're just going to dry up. There won't be anything, right, your finger in their dust. Because they have forsaken the spring of living water. Let's go to Revelation 7. I'm just going to the end. Don't you like to read the end sometimes? Actually, I took a speed reading class in college because I got freaked out. I was not absorbing all the information I needed to at the rate I needed to. So I took a speed reading class that helped me quite a bit. And one of the things they tell you to do is to read the end and parts in between so that while you're reading, you actually are reading with an expectation rather than just a let it come to me approach. You actually have an idea what's coming, so you actually have more of a question in your mind. How's that going to be answered in between the lines? And so it might be good sometimes, and we're going to do it right now, to read the ending. I don't know about you, but Revelation isn't quite as interesting to me all the time because it has a lot of weird stuff going on, doesn't it? And I'm glad I don't have to completely understand all of that. But this part is kind of precious, I believe. Revelation 7:17, the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eye. This is the end. Not completely, because we're going to go to the end now. Revelation 22 and verse 1. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, down the middle of the great street of the city. Huh, this is on the other side. I thought you went across the river to get to the other side. No, you go across the river, and there, the river just keeps going up there. It's still life. Bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. That kind of sounds like Ezekiel, doesn't it? And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. Who's that talking about? It's talking about me. But why is it talking about me? It's because I'm thirsting for him now. Amen? I'm glad that there's an end that we can look towards, but we don't have to wait to get in the river. In fact, to be in that river later on, to be in that place, we get in there now. Is that good? The Holy Spirit is such a necessary part of that, isn't it? Jesus, I believe, again, Ezekiel was prophesying the Holy Spirit. And what's the necessity of that again? Because I don't know about you, but I don't see Jesus walking around in sandals right now. We can see him in the Word, but he sent his Spirit. And by the Spirit, we can know him. Amen? And I'm thankful that he's a 21st century. I about said 20th century. Tell you how old I am. He's a 21st century relevancy. He lived back then, but he's just as real today as ever. Amen? You know, you don't have to fix the Word. You don't have to. I kind of like reading like the Message and stuff sometimes. But the core of what it is the same. And it will always be. And the Holy Spirit makes it come alive. Makes it relevant. He wants to. And what's relevant? What do I need right now? All who are hungry. All who are needy. All who are thirsty. Come to him and he'll give of the water of life freely. Amen? Hallelujah. Father, we thank you so much for your word tonight. We thank you that we have a continual source of life flowing from the inside of us, Lord God. We're not without. We can be satisfied in whatever area of our life that there's a need, whatever area that it might seem like it's a dry place, you want to satisfy. You've promised that you would. If there's ever a time, Lord God, that we feel like we're forsaken by you, it's a lie, because you never do. If there's ever that perception, it's maybe because we've forsaken you. We've left the well. Father, I thank you that we can go deeper and deeper into the waters till we're submerged, till the water's completely covering us. And as we are, we're part of that flow of the Spirit in these days. It's going to bring life, restoration, and healing. Lord, I thank you that your prophecies are in place. They're not going to change. They're going to be accomplished. Lord, when we look at them, we don't have to just look at them like good ideas. But they're what we are living in, what we are a part of, Lord God. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. Lord, we're going to be filled with your Spirit continually. We're going to be being filled with that Spirit. And as we are, Lord God, all the things under the water will become invisible compared to the magnitude of your flowing river of water above it. Hallelujah. Oh, robreka semenguringa shiperdos. Imrongi te fingura mesa kem bingulandi andai. Ye croma savrengu shing brengu to fula di abisode. Mitiame se caro nongo shuku. Hefar nima occupo rundu palininga tis. E le fingo rombrangu te far ti palake. Ya picuro no ma soffre no ma si comati cassi che. Precuta far te che si incombrangu te far. Precusci che er ninga si che. Not to feel condemned. Not to look to the dark places. But to be compelled to be drawn by that thirst. To be drawn by that thirst to the well. To be familiar with that place. More so than the other watering holes. To be gratified by that place. More so. And to experience the life that can only come from the giver of life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Flow, Lord God. Flow, river of life. Flow from our well, Lord God. Bring healing. Bring restoration. Bring salvation. Hallelujah. Lord, I lift up a prayer, Father, that this church body will be going deeper and deeper. Lord, we'll not be satisfied to just sit on the banks. We'll not be satisfied to just put our toe in, Lord God. We'll go deeper and deeper until all the things around us will be covered up by the wonder of who you are and that life that can only come in you. To where our backs have forsaken and are turned to those other wells, to those other cisterns that cannot even hold water. Turn our backs completely on those things, Lord God. Hallelujah. No longer discouraged by anything that we're experiencing. But our faces fixed on you. Hallelujah. Lord, I just speak that over this body. Every time we come together, our faces are going to be fixed on you. Satisfied in you. Going to the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus. Going there with a need and having it met. Taking somebody with us to that place. Spilling up and spilling over. Springing up and spilling over with the life that you pour through us. Hallelujah. God, I give you thanks for this time tonight. Time of refreshing. Time of being satisfied by your water. So grateful for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.